serves to be our last opportunity to be together for camp meeting this year. Let Brother Ryan know how much we love him and appreciate him for coming to take our service to this morning. John chapter 5, John chapter 5, hallelujah. Pastor, thank you for everything you've done for me, your friendship most of all, Brother Carl. What a blessing he's been to me. There's several men that I talk to on a regular, I say several, three or four, that are regularly involved in my life, leaders, pastors, preachers. Your pastor is one of those that I talk to on a regular basis that I need so much, and I'm so grateful for his friendship. Thank you for all of your hospitality. Been a wonderful time. Got to spend time above Mitchell, hitting that little white ball around yesterday. That was such a blast, man. Eight of us went golfing and it was a good time. Carl and Corey think they won. I seen them out of bounds several times. I don't think they counted those shots. They did something. I don't know. They beat us by one. I'm sure there's a little bit of smidgen in there somewhere, because I felt like a champion when I left. So I don't know if, I just felt deep down inside that something was being skewed, or I don't know. I felt like Bubba and I really put it on them. But the time will tell. On the judgment day, we will not display. Amen. You know, golf is the only thing that preachers and Christians can kind of fudge a little bit, you know? It's like, yeah. No, I'm just playing. They said they won. They was two over. We was three over. They beat us by one. Whatever. John chapter 5. Amen. John chapter 5. Let's look to it here this morning. Stand for the reading of God's word if you're able to. John chapter number 5. I'm going to slow down a little bit. This morning, I'm going to preach to you, as a pastor, I'm going to preach to you some things, and I feel like some things that we need to hear. I want to deal with some very, I believe, pressing issues that I believe people are going through today, and I want you to hear me. John chapter 5, verse number 1, and after this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there was at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. And these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, a blind, halt, and withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool, and he troubled the water. Whosoever then, first after the troubling of the water, stepped in and was made whole of whatever disease that he had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had now been in a long time in that case, he said unto him, "Will you be made whole?" The impotent man answered, said, "Sir, I have no man when the water's troubled to put me in the pool, but while I'm coming, another step down before me." Jesus said unto him, "Arise, take up your bed, and walk." The Bible said, and immediately the man was made whole, and he took up his bed, and he walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews therefore said unto him that was cured, "It's the Sabbath day. It's not lawful for thee to carry your bed." He answered them, "He that made me whole, the same said unto me, 'Take up your bed and walk.'" They asked them, "What then, or who was this man that said that unto thee, 'Take up your bed and walk?'" And he that was healed wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. And afterwards, Jesus findeth him in the temple, said unto him, "Behold, you are made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus that made him whole. Amen. How many's ever heard this message, this passage of scripture before? Pretty popular, right? I want to preach to you for just a few moments on a reservation for one. A reservation for one. A reservation for one. Father, we love you and thank you, Lord, for your presence, for your word. God, for what, Lord, you're going to do today. I believe there's some deep hurts that you're interested in healing today. I believe, Lord, that there's some long-time cases that you want to visit today. And I pray that you'd anoint me, Lord, to declare your word with a boldness and an authority, God. And most of all, that sweet, precious anointing that I can do nothing without, that you would lend it to me, God, again, and anoint me, Lord, to convey your truth. In Jesus' name we pray, and the church said amen. Amen. A reservation for one. Amen. Has life dealt you a rotten hand lately? It seems like the more that I travel and the more that I visit, that sometimes there's a spirit of a kind of oppression, a spirit of just, just mental anguish that is in the midst. It seems like that the enemy is in an all-out attack to try to affect men and women of God. And I believe here lately, especially the last several months, I believe that there is a strategic attack of the enemy to bring discouragement upon some of God's mightiest warriors in my book. I have seen the Lord. I have talked with people that are afflicted. They are depressed. They are tormented in ways that they never have been before. And every once in a while, you get to a point in your life where honestly, you just feel like whining a little bit. Have you ever felt like you wanted to throw yourself a pity party? Have you ever felt like you wanted to just crawl in to your room away from everybody and just begin to let it unload and begin to cry out in a way that nobody even knows? Some of you here this morning, you probably thrown yourself a pity party here in the last several months when nobody knew about it. And if only I could take that wrong step back, or if only I could take that wrong decision back, if only I could redo those 30 seconds. Why did this happen? Why did this happen to me? And sometimes it's embarrassing to admit, but if you are not careful, self-pity will get the best of you. Are you listening to me this morning? Self-pity will come, and it seems incredibly silly, and it seems incredibly childish, but if you are not careful, self-pity will come in and begin to absolutely dominate your life. When you feel like that either nobody has it worse than me, nobody is going through anything more than I'm going through, and if you are not careful, self-pity will get the best of you and your life. And what's more is the pity party that you're throwing for yourself is really just a party of one. Nobody else is invited to the festivities. Nobody else is invited to the party. Nobody else is invited to help you with your grief. It is a party of one. You close the door, you cry, you close the door, you pout, you close the door, and nobody else can be there to help you because you don't want advice, you don't want opinions, you don't want prayer, you don't want a pat on the back, you don't want anybody that will try to talk you out of throwing yourself that party. I'm preaching to you and you don't know. I said you're enjoying your pity party. You're enjoying the time where, and sometimes our moans and our complaints are invitations we issue so that others will come and comfort us. How many heard the saying, misery loves company? In other words, even misery loves for you to come. And when you're in self-pity, there is nothing more that you like than for someone to come and the misery loves company. And you want to tell them how miserable your life is. And you want to tell them how deep your problems are. And you want to tell them just how bad everything is. And sooner or later, they're walking down hanging their nose just like you were. Misery loves company. Yet when I'm full of self-pity, I don't want to hear about your misery. I don't want to hear about your problems. It's my party, and I'll cry if I want to.
There you go.
Right?
Yeah.
It's my party, and I'll cry. It's my party, and I'll cry if I want to. It's my depression, and I'll cry if I want to. It's my dilemma. Don't try to talk me out of it. Don't you try to tell me that God's bigger than my pain. Don't you try to tell me that God's a healer. Don't you try to tell me that God's here for me. It's my party, and I'm going to cry if I want to. It's self-pity. Begins to get the best of us. Yes, It begins to work on us. And understand, many times we whisper soothing words to ourselves. No one appreciates what I'm going through. Why is everyone being so unfair? Why is this always happening to me? Someday they'll be sorry. God, why are you doing this to me? Listen, friend, there's a lot of unhappy people around us all the time, even in the church. People that are full of grief and sorrow and pain and misery. Check out the expressions of students in the hallways, or the drivers in other cars, or the commuters that are crouching over their Wall Street journals. There's a lot of depression in our world, friend. Why? There's the shoppers in the grocery stores. Everybody's ticked off. Everybody's ready. Everybody's ready to lose it. Everybody's ready to fly off the handle. We live in a world today that we are masking our pain, and we are masking the real issues of life, and we're ready to flip out on our husband, flip out on our wife, flip out on our friends. We're ready to just tell them what we think. I want to tell you, friend, even we are reserving our seat by the pool. Reservation for one. There's a lot of unhappy people. Wealth and fame is no protection against despair. I love what Albert Einstein said. He said, it's strange to be known so universally, yet be so lonely. In other words, I got a lot of friends. I got a lot of people in my life, but I'm so lonely. I got a lot of people I go to church with, but I feel like I'm in this battle alone. I got a lot of people that I associate with, but there is no one that really knows what I'm going through. Marilyn Monroe said, sometimes I think the only people that stay with me and really listen to me are the people that I hire and the people that I pay. In other words, if they wasn't on my payroll, I wouldn't have a friend in the world. Really? If they wasn't on my bed, it's so bad, friends. Many times it's so bad in our life. I read about it online the other day that there was over in China, one of the most popular gathering places in the Chinese city of Beijing. It's not a sports bar and it's not an internet cafe, but really it's a bar with a sofa, and there's a few tablets and there's a few tissues. Actually, there's a lot of tissues. And over there in China, it's the city's first, they call it a cry bar. In other words, you can walk into that bar. There's a lot of tissues. There's nobody gonna bug you. You can walk into that bar. You can sit down and you can just have yourself a good cry. And they pay $6 an hour to walk in there and just begin to boo-hoo all of their troubles away. You think I'm kidding? I'm serious. Yeah. You Google it. It's a cry bar because no people don't have anywhere they can go to cry. So for $6 an hour, they'll go sit in this cry bar and begin to just unload. In a bizarre way, people often want to cry, but they don't know where to go. And in a bizarre way, sometimes it feels good to be stuck in the mud. Sometimes it feels good to feel bad.
Oh, God, there it is.
You don't want me to preach, is it? I said sometimes it feels good to feel bad. The attention that you get feels good. Come on now. I said sometimes it feels good to be bad. And this is where that man laying by the pool was. Even he was in a position to where he felt pretty good to feel bad. I wish I could preach to you and let you know that self-pity sometimes can be a powerful drug. When you feel sorry for yourself, even it's a powerful drug. And the other method of dealing with despair is running from it. Even understand that there are people today, even give in to self-pity or to give up and run away. Those are only options. Those are not our only options. Give in to self-pity or run away from it all. Is that our only option? Is that the only thing we can do with real pain? I told you I was going to slow down today. Is that the only thing we can do with real grief and sorrow? Here we were. And patience far and wide were carried to Jerusalem, and they was deposited in the shade of its five columned walls. And I want you to notice with me the sea of humanity that existed around this pool that I'm preaching about. The sea of humanity that was there, the needy and the worn and the tired and the sick and the stench and the moans. I mean, this was like a convalescent home, man. I mean, the stench and the moans and everything that was going on around that pool. This was not a place that you just want to go hang out for a little bit. I want you to notice the people that were there. It seemed perfectly peaceful compared to the moment when bubbles percolated in these pools, and when the bubbles percolated, it was a sign that healing power was the most potent. In other words, it was a season when suddenly the primitive hospital, suddenly all of a sudden the primitive hospital was there, all of a sudden became a madhouse of people jumping, people running, people trying to push you out of the way so that they could get to their healing, because they knew it was only during this season. I want you to notice the mad chaos that took place when these waters were troubled. Because the winner received the best price of all. He received healing. And the King James suggests that God sent an angel periodically to roll the waters of the pool. And according to the King James, each time he disturbed the water, you know the story, the first one down into the pool would be healed of whatever ailment afflicted him. And what seemed clear was that the superstitious belief of many that lay up around that pool, they surrounded that pool for a reason, and that was so that they could somehow win the health lottery. In other words, when the water was stirred, I want to win the health lottery. I want to be the first one in. I want to be the first one that's healed. I want to be the first one that's delivered. A matter of fact, even though it's periodic disturbances, and they tell you that there was a natural phenomenon, there was an intermittent underground spring that would burst from time to time. Even I don't know if it was a natural phenomenon or if it was an angel that troubled the water. I've read both sides of it, that sometimes it was something natural or it was something supernatural. I don't know if it was a combination of them both, if it was a bubbling hot spring or if it was really an angel, but at any rate, Jesus had an agenda. And he makes that way to the pool that day. And the people waiting there that would resemble a doctor's office, a waiting room without appointments. I mean, that'd be crazy. And in that line, he noticed this man been sick for 38 years. He chooses one man with some form of paralysis. And he engages this man with a conversation. He says, "Sir, do you want to get well?" Now, listen. I love this story about an angel troubling the water. But can I tell you, as a preacher and really a follower of Jesus, I got a little problem with it. Let me tell you what my problem is. I don't serve a God, I don't think, that would cause such a horrible scene of selfishness and a disregard for humanity to think that only the fit could get in that pool. Right. Yeah. I kind of got a problem with that. Yeah. Yeah. You say, what are you talking about, Prick? Can I just be honest with you? I got a problem with it. I don't serve a God that I believe is so partial that he would say, amen. Matter of fact, this story proves that he's not that God. Because he brought the healing to the man. He didn't need the pool. But I don't think, it's almost like if you're the fastest, if you're the quickest, if you're the most well, you get in that water and you win a health lottery, and sorry for everybody else. You're out. You don't get no healing. You don't get no deliverance. And possibly only the strong, possibly only the rude, possibly only the self-centered could push their way into that water and get their nearest slot. Maybe the rich. Maybe they'd buy it. I don't know. Maybe those with the strongest, healthiest friends would be the ones that would make it. But something must have been in the scene. Something must have been crazy. Look, guys, the water's moving. And all of a sudden, it's a bunch of chaos. Yeah. Amen. Do you see it with me? What a mad rush. With the hopes that the weakest, the neediest, someone more nimble, and one poor cripple heard that cry for 38 years. Matter of fact, he had no chance. Because as soon as he dragged his crippled body 2 feet, he got word. So and so got in.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
So. And so they begin the process again. Now listen, follow with me. He didn't have a chance. Another one stepped into the pool. And no doubt, I don't believe that Jesus would have any part in this Wheel of Fortune pool. I'm sorry, it just does not depict to me the nature of the God that I serve. I'm sorry, I got a problem with it because I just go, and I understand the Bible, I'm not trying to negate it, but I'm trying to say there's more to the story than what is on the surface. I don't believe that God relegates his healing to the able. I don't believe that God relegates his healing to those that have friends. I don't believe that God relegates his healing to those that are of affluence and got money. I got a little problem with it. Our God is not running a Wheel of Fortune pool. Are you with me? No doubt many was healed. And some people truly believe God were healed miraculously. I believe it. But this patient never had a chance. He could not move off of his mat. He could not get away. No one plunged him into the pool. Who could blame him for sinking into self-pity? He didn't have no one. The Bible says the story changed. You know, Bethesda means house of mercy, but for this man, it was a house of misery. It wasn't no house of mercy. It was a house of misery. Watching other people get in 38 years. Come on, man. 38 years. Year 37, somebody else. Year 36, somebody else. I mean, it must be understood that every poor soul laying by the water had already had something better than a discriminating move of the water. And this is what I want to tell you, that this discriminating move of the water that was only good for one person, Jesus showed up on the scene to prove that I am bigger than that. I am not discriminating. I am not for one. I am not just for you and not for him. I am not a discriminating God, and I'm not partial with how I measure out my healing. If he needs it, he'll get it. If he needs it, he'll get it. If you can't get to the pool, I'll bring the pool to you. I'll bring it to you. Now, God gave us a greater promise. And according to the scriptures, this is what I believe. What greater promise? Listen to what God told us. Moses, if you'll diligently hearken the voice of the Lord, we'll do that what's right. I'll give ear to your commandments, keep my statutes. I'll put none of these diseases on you. That's what God told Moses. I brought up the Egyptians. I'm the Lord God that healeth thee. Can I preach to you? He told David, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits, who forgiveth all thy iniquities and healeth all. Can I say it again? And healeth all of your diseases. He told the prophets, you're not going to contend forever, neither will they always be angry. For the spirits that fell before me and the souls which I made. He said, the iniquity of his covenants, I was mad, and I smote him, I hid me, and was wroth, and he went on forwardly, backsliding. But he said, come, and let us return to the Lord, for he has torn, and he will heal us. He has smitten, and he will bind us. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be saved. And listen, this is what I want you to get. According to the scriptures, according to the scriptures, these men were waiting for the wrong thing. Because they was told to wait on the Lord and upon his word alone. But there are multitudes. They was waiting for the moving of the water when they should have been waiting on the Lord. They placed a lot of confidence in the water when it should have been placed on their healer. They was waiting for the right atmosphere when it really didn't need the atmosphere. You just need the right God. Are you listening to me? They was waiting for the right moment, but they did not need to be waiting on the moment. They needed to be waiting on God. They was waiting for, they placed a a lot of confidence in that move of the water. One time a year, they thought, man, this is a health lottery. This is when we can get it. But understand this, my God's so big that he lets us know that I am not a once a year healing type of God. If you wait on me, I will find you where you are. There's multitudes of Christians today who are spiritually helpless and impotent because of a lingering battle in their life. They lay helpless on their bed of depression and despair, always hoping for a miracle, always reaching out for love, always waiting for someone to stir things up, to make it happen. They spend their life waiting for that one life-changing miracle. They drag themselves to meeting after meeting, to camp meeting after camp meeting. Are you listening to me? Counseling sessions and seminars. They tell their story of woe to this one, and they retell their story of woe to that one. They're telling it here, they're telling it there, they're telling it there, they're telling it there. But God is trying to let us know nothing is changes, nothing changes. And one day, the stranger walks up to this man and says, hey, do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? Do I want to get well? What in the world? Of course. I mean, who'd want to live their life among sickness and death? Perhaps maybe he misunderstood the question. Maybe the stranger was asking why he wasn't cured yet.
Right. Yeah.
Listen, sir, I don't have no one help me get in the pool when the water's stirred. What I'm trying to get in, someone else heads down. But the stranger did not ask. Why can't you get in the pool? What I'm trying to say is that when God, the Lord asked him, do you want to get well? He answered the question as to why he couldn't get well. He said, sir, I don't have no man. Jesus didn't ask him why he couldn't get in the pool. He just asked him, hey, do you want to get well? Right? In other words, I don't need your excuses as to why you've been here for 38 years. I don't need you to tell me about why you're like this. I don't need you to tell me about everything that's happened to make you like this. That's like you telling me, sir, there's no man to pay that. I don't need to know why you can't get in the pool. Listen, sooner or later, you're going to have to realize that excuses are not going to get you well. Excuses are not going to get you healing. When you retell your story and try to give you a reason for why you are like you are, that ain't going to make you well. Jesus didn't say, why can't you get in the pool? He said, do you want to be healed? Do you want to be healed? I know there's danger. Someone come to the piano, it'll help me close quickly. 12:30, we start getting nervous. I know.
I'm fine.
Hallelujah. God bless you. Do you want to get well?
Hallelujah.
Do you want to get well?
Oh, Jesus.
Jesus knew the man had lost his will to be well.
Yeah.
You're not hearing me.
Yeah.
I said Jesus knew that he lost his will to be well. Because for 38 years, his mat marked his place. For 38 years, everybody knew where that man laid. As a matter of fact, if a newbie showed up and tried to take his spot, I don't think he got it. That's so-and-so's spot. He's been here 38 years. You can put your mat over there, but so-and-so's is right here. And so for 38 years, he had a reservation of one at the pool. For 38 years, his routine was, I'm sick, I'm going to go, I'm going to lay down, I'm going to talk about my agony, I'm going to talk about my pain.
Yes, sir.
And tomorrow, I'm going to do it all over again.
Yeah.
And sometime during this year, there's going to be a little stir, but I don't get too stirred up about it because I don't have enough strength even to do it. And so I honestly believe after year 30, this man didn't even make much of an effort to get in the pool. Can I just use my imagination?
Yeah.
Because this was his lifestyle.
Yeah.
Being sick, laying down, talking about his misery. It's like David Wilkerson found a teenage boy living in a dark, rat-infested basement in New York City. And he walked and he visited him. His bed was a pile of filthy rags and he's living like a wild dog. He was hopelessly addicted to heroin, and David Wilkerson went and found him. He said, and I took him to our drug center and I gave him new clothes and I gave him a clean bed and I gave him good food and I gave him lots of love and I gave him the gospel, but he was miserable and he soon returned and ditched out of our program and went right back to his dungeon. He was miserable, and he said, I found him again, and he told me, he said, preacher, you see it as a hole, but to me it's home. I'm comfortable down here. I got used to it. I like being alone. Don't try to change me, preacher. Don't come back. This is my life. And a year later, the young man died of hepatitis. Right in the same hole that the preacher tried to grab him out of. And there are so many people. And that's why when Jesus seen this one, he went to him and he knew his routine. He said, man, do you want to get well? You see, it's a sad but true that many hurting people cannot survive without their sorrow and their pain. Oh, you're not letting me preach to you. They fell in love with their pain. And they fell in love with their sorrow. And they don't want to get well. They fell in love with the excuses. They fell in love with the attention. You're not listening to me, man. And if they got well, they wouldn't even know how to live anymore. Because they're so accustomed to live the life that they've lived. That's why Jesus told him. He asked him, sir, do you want to get well?
Yeah.
Do you want to get well? 38 years of dashed hopes and unbearable sufferings. Then he said, I have no man. I never move up in line because there is no line. It's every invalid for himself. There's no line. It's like a mad rush. I don't have no man. I can't get well. Understand, Jesus, and this is what I love to him. He said, listen, do you want to get well? He didn't say, why can't you get well? And Jesus asked him, do you want to be healed? What? And then Jesus said, now I want you to take up your bed. That outline, that routine. I love how Jesus told him, you need to take up your bed and walk. What Jesus was trying to say, oh, you need to get this. What Jesus was trying to say is that you're not coming back here, and I want you to remove any evidence that you've ever been here. Take up your bed and walk. You're not coming back here, I believe is what it said first of all. But then he said, I also want you to remove any evidence that you have ever even been here. You're moving on to something better. People say, save me a seat by the pool. That's my place. That's my comfortable place. That's where I'm used to living. That's my routine. Reservation for one. I know it's not the way I used to be, but this is a new me. Deal with it. I know this ain't who I used to be, but get used to it. This is me now. Don't torment me. Don't tell me I don't belong here. Come on, somebody. Lay it in our comfortable place. Jesus finds him. Said, do you want to get well? Stand with me all over this building this morning. Can I speak to you? I feel like I'm dealing with some deep issues this morning, and that's okay. I wanted to. I'm a practical preacher. I want to preach where you are. I don't want to just get you jumping and shouting. I want to deal with your problems. The Word of God is very applicable to what you're going through right now. Can I tell you that oftentimes we abandon our desire for wholeness because we're deeply afraid? I don't know if it's we're afraid of being rejected. I don't know if it's afraid we're afraid of having to relearn how to live. You know what I mean? It's like, well, pray for me to get a job. Wait, don't pray for me to get a job because I get a check coming every month. If I got a job, then I wouldn't get the check. You know what I mean? So it's almost like, it's almost like, God, do it, but don't do it. Heal me, but let me get that disability check still. Are you listening? It's almost like, God, I want you to do this, but I'm a little scared too. And so we hold back from really getting healing and really getting deliverance because of our fear of the unknown. Because this has become what you've known. And I want to tell you, sometimes it's a fearful thing to surrender the security of the present for the uncertainty of the future. But I still feel like God has come to ask you, do you want to get well?
Hallelujah. Amen.
Every head bowed all over this building right now. Are you ready to abandon your normality? Are you ready to walk away from that mat that you've been laying on for so long? You've conditioned yourself to think it's your normal life. But I come here to tell you right now, man, it is not God's will you spend one more year by that pool. God wants to make you well. Are you here today? And you'd be the first to come to the front of this church and say, Pastor, I need healing in my life over some things and some ailments that is going on, and I want to step forward. I want to take up my bed and walk this morning to be different. I want to accept my healing. Is there anyone here? I want you to come right now. Amen. There's no shame in this place. Come on. There is no shame in this place. We are believing God to make you well. You can feel 100% confidence that you are stepping into a new you this morning. Nobody will judge you. Nobody will talk about you. Nobody's going to wonder what's going on with you. Right now, this morning, it's going to be a new normal for you. God is able to do miraculous things in your life. Do you want to get well?
Thank you.
I know this service ain't sky high. I didn't think it would be. It's fine with me. I'm perfectly normal right here. I'm happy right here. Hallelujah. This is where the gospel begins to take roots and change lives. This is where the Lord begins to make well. We don't need a bunch of jumping and shouting. We need our hearts and our lives and our minds to be changed by the power of the gospel. The gospel heals. Hallelujah. The gospel makes well. And I want to tell you, you cannot be ashamed to bring your deepest needs at the foot of the cross. Is there anyone else? I thank you so much, those of you that are here, your honesty. Is there anyone else here today? Say, I've got some deep needs in my life. I'm ready to abandon my normality and challenge myself to be different. Some of you, your normality, come on somebody, is living off of your prescription drugs, living off of your little bit of sin here and there. Your normality is getting a little bit of lust every once in a while. God's trying to tell you that it's time to break free and to challenge Him to really change you. To change you.
Yes.
I'm telling you right now, church, I am so sick of the devil allowing the church to be weak in these areas.
God help me, God help us, God help us.
And you call me old-fashioned. You call me whatever you want to call me. And I know there's people that deal with chronic pain, and I'm not here to condemn you, but I am here to tell you, if you're not careful, those things become a life-changing stronghold in your life. And I refuse to shut up about it. I refuse to shut up about it. I refuse to act like it's normal. I refuse to act like the church is just going to accept it. I want to tell you right now, there is deliverance in the name of Jesus, where you are never the same again. God is able to move into a life where you can be free. Some of you, your anticipation in church depends on if you got your prescription or not. You can get in if you need to run out of pills. Really? You can have revival. I'm not condemning you. And I'm not saying everyone in this building, some of you don't need it. Don't try to read into extremes. But I'm telling you right now, if your life depends on something that this world can hand you, and your victory depends on something this doctor can hand you, then you got a problem.
That's right.
Oh, how true.
Do you want to be made well? Do you want to be made well? Brother Joey, I'm a little old school. I just think it's Jesus plus nothing. I don't need anything else. I'm sorry, man. I don't need anything else.